Series 10. Troutbridge Electrifies Portsmouth, also known as Lighting Up.
Ladies and gentlemen, we present The Navy Lark by Lawrie Wyman and starring Stephen Murray, John Pertwee and Leslie Phillips. I've no idea who it was who wrote Absence Makes the Heart Grow Fonder, but it certainly wasn't Captain Povey about the crew of HMS Troutbridge. For some months now, with Troutbridge at sea and well away from Portsmouth Dockyard, life in Captain Povey's office has gone smoothly. Except for the day he told a disreputable-looking old gentleman cutting the hedge outside the Admiral's house to smarten himself up a bit if he wished to continue being employed. Unfortunately, the disreputable-looking old gentleman was the Admiral. In his gardening clothes. However, after abject apologies, polishing the Admiral's gardening boots for half an hour, and finally ending up having to cut the Admiral's hedge himself, Captain Povey managed to survive with his commission intact. Whether it will still be intact after what is going to happen to him in his office today is another matter.
Come in, come in. Ah, oh, it's you, Ranchasen. Well, what is it? And be quick about it, because I'm a very busy man.
So I see, sir. And if you'll take my advice, you won't bother to water those potted plants any longer, because they died 3 weeks ago.
Don't be ridiculous, Ranchasen. They can't have died. My dear wife Ramona gave them to me to look after while she's away visiting her dear mother.
Have you tried giving them the kiss of life, sir?
Kiss of life? Ranchasen, what do you think would happen to my authority if someone happened to be passing and glanced up at my office window and saw me being, well, amorous with a busy Lizzie?
Well, they'd probably just think you'd joined the flower people, sir.
Ranchasen, that is quite enough. Now, what did you want?
Well, I thought you'd like to know that Ernie has finally turned up.
Ernie? Ernie's turned up? Who for? You or me?
Oh, you, of course, sir.
Are you sure?
A positive, sir.
I'm rich, I'm rich. Henry's copped at last. Oh, I'm rich. Oh, this is it. Yes. A yacht moored in the Bahamas, that's the first thing. And then a Rolls Royce and a place in the country. No, not in the country. In the south of France. Oh, good old Ernie. Oh, happy day. Happy Henry. Now Povey is a rich man.
Oi, fiddler.
Yes?
I think you'd better come down off your roof. I have a feeling we're not talking about the same Ernie.
What?
The Ernie who has turned up for you isn't a premium bond. He's the foreman of the dockyard. He wants to see you. And he's in the outer office.
Ernie from the dockyard?
Yes, sir. Would you like to sit down, sir?
Don't be ridiculous, Ranchasen. Just a minute. What's the date? Where's the calendar? No, it can't be yet. I marked it in black. They can't be back yet, surely. My blood pressure's only just got back to normal again.
If you were referring to HMS Troutbridge completing her commission and being due back, sir...
Well?
Hard luck they are. Come in, Ernie. Captain Povey will see you now.
Why me? That's what I want to know, Captain. Why me?
Now, just a
Why bit. Pick on my gang twice in a row,
eh? I'm quite sure.
I mean, my mate Sid nearly went Bismarck when I told him we got Troutbridge again. Sid does main services, you see.
Main services? Oh, you mean Sid connects ships up with the shore power, telephones and so on when they're in harbour?
Of course.
Well,
Sid's not connected up Troutbridge again. No, not after what they done to Sid last time. Not even if he's paid workman's consternation for a year.
Ernie, what did they do last time?
What did they do? They sent Sid all aglow in 8 foot into the air. That's what they did to Sid. He undoes the manhole in the dockside, connects up his end, and then goes aboard Troutbridge to connect up the shore power there in.
Well,
that there Mr. Phillips had forgotten to say he'd finished with the engines. So Troutbridge was still generating her own power, see? When Sid tries to connect up, the shore power meets the power from the ship's own generators. So Sid cops about 500 volts straight up his... 8 foot up he went.
Oh, dear.
Sid'll strike. I'm warning you, Captain. We'll both strike.
Nonsense.
Well, then, can we have danger money?
No. If anybody's entitled to danger money, it's me. But Sid only has to deal with that char on Troutbridge for a day. I get them all the year round. Now then, Robert, what time is she due to die?
I'm not sure, Captain, but offhand and from the sound of that lot, I'd say they're here.
Mr. Phillips, I don't want to sound like a backseat driver, but...
No, not now, sir, please. I do wish you chaps to stop interrupting a chap when a chap's right in the middle of it.
With respect, sir. It's not only a chap who's right in the middle of it. The old perishing lot of us are.
Congratulations, Mr. Phillips. For a minute, I thought you'd missed that one.
Well, if you must know, so did I, actually. Great.
Sorry pardon, Mr. Barge, gentlemen.
I'll give you a sorry pardon and all if I come up there, you yellow-headed peril. Are you all blundering and bashing about in this blasted harbour? I don't reckon you know your... from your elbow.
Well, really, if that's your attitude, you know what you are, don't you? You're a...
No, Mr. Phillips, we don't want to lower ourselves to his level.
That we don't, sir. He just sunk.
Oh, well done. At least that's got him out of my way.
Ruthless, that's what he is. Ruthless. Look, next time, Mr. Phillips, sir, why don't you give the rest of the shipping in the harbour a sporting chance?
What do you mean, Chief?
Well, signal ahead, sir, and give them the option of scuttling themselves before you come in.
Oh, very funny. Now, I want complete quiet while I come alongside. Now, this is the tricky bit.
You mean the rest was easy?
Quiet, please. Sir is navigating. Now, as I remember it, if I get the sticking out bit on the front in line with the, just in line with the bathroom window of the Wren's quarters, and the right-hand gun pointing straight at the naffy, then with the wardroom porthole looking straight across the offside headlamp on the Admiral's car, and the dent on our starn opposite the big gash on the dock gates, all we need now is full ahead both and, left hand down a bit.
Excuse me, sir, but you've missed something out.
What?
Everybody down!
Lummy, that was close.
Very.
Bridge number one speaking.
Starboard lookout here, sir. Leading Seaman Goldstein chat in. I just thought you'd like to know, my bits arrived in Portsmouth. Where's yours?
No, it's all right, Goldstein. We're still with you.
Oh, well, that's a relief, sir. At the speed Mr. Phillips hit the dock, you could have been anywhere.
Now, Goldstein.
Incidentally, if it's of any interest, in the unlikely event that you should ever happen to want me for anything further, you'll find me sitting on one of the dockside bollards.
What? Goldstein, I didn't give you permission to go ashore.
Oh, I haven't gone ashore. But due to Mr. Phillips' natty bit of navigation, the dockside bollards come aboard.
Oh. In that case, you better put it back. We haven't signed for it.
I don't see why I should put it back, sir. Why can't these other two take it with them and they go?
Other two? What other two?
Well, a couple of civvies who were leaning on it when it got bunched on board. They brought it with them. They can take it back, I say.
Goldstein. No, really, he's getting worse, you know.
Never mind, sir. Wait until Wales declares independence.
Well, what good will that do?
We can intern him as an undesirable alien.
Yes. Right, come on, you two. Get the ship made fast, and then we better go down on the dockside and see just how much damage we've done this time. Well, Chief, how bad is the damage?
I would remind you, officer and gents both, that damage to naval vessels comes in three sizes. A, B, and C.
Go on.
Well, damage type A is slap a coot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.